I want you to get your Bible and get right there in Mark chapter 10, verses 45 through 52 in just a moment. Just a moment. The title of my message today is A Lesson from the Blind Man, the Beggar, by the name of Bartimaeus. Bartimaeus. We can always learn things from others, because we all travel along life's journey. We all got a testimony. We all got experiences. Some good, some bad. But we learn from the bad so we can produce the good. I say we learn from the bad so we can produce the good. In every bad situation, amen, God is molding us and shaping us to depend upon Him more than ever before. And when we learn, I said, when we learn, we grow in the Lord to be a better light for Him. Matter of fact, He gives us more power. More power. We need more power in our lives today than we ever needed before. God knew that we needed power from above to be an effective witness for Him. Matter of fact, He told His disciples to go into the upper room and pray until they was endued with power from above. Endured. The problem we have today, friend, today, we don't pray enough. We don't pray enough. We do a 2 or 3 second prayer most of the time, and that's it. When is a time that you actually prayed all day long? When is a time that you actually fasted and prayed all day long? When was there a time that you, amen, was in a constant attitude of prayer? Jesus tells us in Luke 18:1, men always ought to pray. He didn't put a stipulation on it. He said men always ought to pray. And in the latter part of that, He said, because you won't faint, amen, if you pray. You won't give up hope if you pray. Amen. Satan, amen, has no way to get in, amen, if you pray and seek My face. We need to pray. We need to pray and pray earnestly before God, that God will give us the answers to many of our problems and our circumstances. But we got to do something. We got to do something. And hopefully you'll learn what to do from this lesson from the blind Bartimaeus. You got to ask the blind man, because he saw it all. Just the thought. Hello. Just the thought. Just the thought. Shortly after returning home from World War II, a man named Earl decided he's going to buy a television set. He went to the store and asked for a demonstration. He was impressed, but decided to postpone that purchase. It was a little too expensive for him. A couple of years later, Earl reconsidered buying that TV, but again decided against it. There wasn't enough station in the city where he was living that offered sufficient variety of channels for him. Later, when his city was the home of several new stations, he considered getting that TV again, but he didn't. He heard that in a couple of years, color television was coming out. Y'all remember color television? Let me tell you, our first color television was one of them things you put on in front of it. Y'all remember that? Some of you remember. You know, the Christmas tree what we had a spinning thing with colors on it. Didn't have all them color lights you buy now and put on them. Y'all remember them? Good. I ain't the only one old in here. Yeah. Color television set. Young folks said, what in the world is a color television set? You see everything there in color. Was black and white. Black and white. Earl decided he was going to get one of these new color televisions. So he waited. He heard the vacuum tubes that was in the old TV set was going to be solid state. Y'all remember the tubes? Young people say, I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. They don't even remember a phone hanging on the wall today. Hello? You used to have to go to the phone booth. You didn't have one in your pocket. You had to go to the phone booth. And ain't too many phone booths left in America. Solid state. So he waited a little while longer. If you've been listening to this story, you detected a pattern so far. Earl has a hesitation problem. Hello? He's hesitating. Finally, Earl's wife said, it takes a good wife. I waited long enough. Go to the appliance store and give me that TV set. At last, Earl, he goes down to buy the TV. Just as the salesman was saying, cash or credit. Earl began telling his story. He said, you know, I never owned a TV before, and I can't wait to get my TV set home, because there's a show I always wanted to watch. It's called Gunsmoke. The salesman said, oh, Earl, I got bad news for you. Gunsmoke was canceled in the 1970s. Earl stood at the man in disbelief. He said, they cancel Gunsmoke? He said, forget it. I ain't buying a TV now. You know, a lot of folks are just like Earl. They know what they want out of life. Are you listening? They know what they want out of life, or goals to achieve, or at least they got a pretty good understanding and idea what they want to do, but they just can't bring themselves to do it. To do it. So today, in Mark's gospel, we find here the scriptures in verse 45 that says, for even the Son of Man came not to be ministered to, but to minister and to give his life for a ransom for many. And they came to Jericho. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples, a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway, begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. And many charged him that he shouldn't hold his peace. Now I want you to get this picture. The crowd that was following Jesus that day heard this blind man crying out to the Lord, told him, hush up. Hush up, basically. But he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy. Have mercy on me. And all of a sudden, he catches Jesus' attention. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. That tells me, amen, that he is back in the crowd in some distance. Jesus said, I've heard somebody calling my name. I want him to come forward. He stopped the multitude, honey. He stopped this crowd who told blind Bartimaeus to hush up. He said, I want that man that is calling my name to come forward to where I am. Let him through. Let him through. And they called the blind man and said unto him, be of good comfort. Rise, because he's calling for thee. And notice what he did. And he cast away his garment and rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, Go thy way, thou faith has made thee
whole.
Thou faith has made thee
whole.
And immediately he received his sight. He got what he asked for. And I want you to notice the last thing he said, and he followed Jesus in the way. He got what he wanted, but he did something else. He followed Jesus. Followed Jesus. Followed Jesus. What is taking place here? I see a beggar who's been laying day in and day out, and he's begging for alms to make it through life. He had an impairment. His sight was not there. He didn't have sight available to him. So he had to depend upon others. Others. And others wouldn't efficiently meet his need because he could never receive his sight. They was helping him, but it wasn't substantial enough to sustain him. So he would beg daily, beg daily. And how many of us who are sitting here today, we might not be physically blind, but we are spiritually blind. We are dependent upon the things of the world to suffice us, but it's nothing, amen, that can sustain us. We go back for a little bit and a little bit and a little bit and a little bit and a little bit, but it never brings real change that we need in our life. The first thing blind Bartimaeus did, he realized that he needed a change in his life. He needed someone, amen, to substantially meet his need and that could sustain him through it all. He has heard about Jesus. He has heard about him. No doubt, amen, he has heard many in the town talk about how great of God Jesus was. That he was the Messiah, and that he has came, amen, to seek and to save that which was lost. He's came to give peace and understanding to one's life. He knew that God Almighty, amen, was walking on the face of this green earth. And he knew that he could deliver, amen. Amen, blind man could see again. The dead could rise up. He said, I want what this man got, because I need my sight. I need my help. I need, amen, what he's got. And I need a change. I need a change. I need a change. I need a change. Do you need a change today? Are you tired of living day in and day out in the same old way, in the same old fashion, and just living on the bare minimums of what life could bring? Then, folks, you need a change. He realized he needed a change. And the second thing he did, he cried out to the one who could make the change. He couldn't make it on his own. Oh, many people have said over the years, oh, I might go to church after I change my ways. You'll never change your ways. Hello? You'll never change your way. No matter what good intention you got, you'll never change your ways until you get the sufficient help that needed to make that change. And Jesus is the only one can help you make that change. He knew he needed somebody greater than him. And he cried out, he called out to the one who could make the real change. He cried out to Jesus. Jesus! Jesus! Some of us need to cry out his name. Oh, Jesus, there's power in that name. There is power in that name. Say it again.
Jesus.
There's power in that name. There's power in the name of Jesus. And friend, let me tell you, every time you cry out that name, you got the attention of heaven. You got the attention of heaven. Even though there were a great multitude, did you not see that? The great multitude who told him to hush up, hush up, hush up. I don't care who I disturb. I don't care if it's the one sitting beside me in church. If I need Jesus, I'm going to him. Amen. I don't care if it bothers them. If they'll get over it. Hello. I'm going to get to where my help, amen, is. I'm going to get where I need to get to make that change. I'm going to get to Jesus. Hey, man, friend, let me tell you, they're going to talk about you anyhow, so they might as well talk about you getting to Jesus. Hello? Come on. Oh, they'll call you all kind of names. But don't worry about that. Amen. Just say, get out of the way. Just keep hollering, Jesus, Jesus. But how many times we fall prey to those who hinder us from getting to Jesus. You don't need to go to church today. Won't you go with me fishing? All right. Okie dokie. We're like Tim Conway. Okie dokie. You know? Here we go. What about coming to church and then go fishing? Hello? Woo! We ain't gonna see a change in our life till we get to Jesus. Don't you fall prey to those who will try to drag you out of the way. Some will entice you to do the things of the world that you once did. Come on, let's go down to the bar. Let's have a beer. Or let's go to the street corner and buy some pot or whatever. Listen, hey, don't you tell them, hey, you stay over there. I'm going to Jesus. If you want to come, I'll take you. Come on. Because he's the one that can change your life. He's the one that gets you on a spiritual high. And you ain't got to worry about where you've been. Because when you come back there, you'll be walking. Whoa, you'll be walking right, talking right. Amen. And praise God. I guarantee you won't go to jail for, amen, getting high on God. Amen. Woo. Amen. That's pretty good, actually. Amen. Glory to God. He said, you need to get to Jesus. Get to him. Because Jesus just heard you. He's calling for you. He's calling for you. Didn't it? Jesus said, hey, I hear him. Because when he called out his name, he's got God's full attention. And every time you call out Jesus' name, you got God's full attention. You got his full attention. You just got to tell him what you want. You just got to tell him what you want. Because when you mention his name, you've already trusted him by faith. You know that he could do something greater for you than you can do for yourself. Hello? Are you with me? Well, hang on with me, because I'll let you by the time everybody let your crowd get there. Amen. Yeah. We must recognize that a change is needed, and everybody in here in one way or another is a beggar for something more meaningful, more truthful, and more hopeful than what we have. We all need a change. We must recognize that we need a change. And we must recognize we need the change today, not tomorrow, today. And we must, amen, cry out to Jesus. And third of all, amen, praise God, we got to strip off the things. Strip off. Did y'all see where he laid down his cloak in some of the gospel translation? It said he laid down his cloak. That was, amen, an overcoat basically. And this overcoat was to serve as a thing where people would drop money into it for him. And you know, as he begged and so forth. But he laid that aside. Because depending upon others than God or any other thing besides God is a hindrance. Hello? Bless God, he stripped off that. He said, ain't nothing going to hinder me from getting to Jesus. Nothing's going to hinder me from getting to Jesus. And he was blind, so somebody had to help him to get there. Hello? Or he followed the master's voice. I don't know which. Scriptures don't tell us, but they said he's calling for you. You better get on up there. And he went to where Jesus was. He threw off the thing that would hinder him. Today, friend, you need to throw off the things that are hindering you from getting to where Jesus is. Hebrews 12:1 says, wherefore, seeing we are also compressed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and sin which do so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God for you and me. Blind Bartimaeus knew, amen, what Christ's mission was. He knew that he could change his life. He threw away everything that hindered him, all the sin, whatever that sin meant then. He threw it away when he laid down that cloak. So when you look at that cloak, remember, is that any sin that you have in your life? Do you have a cloak of sin that is holding you back to getting to where Jesus is, where Jesus can make the real change in your life? He threw that cloak to the side. And he said, I'm getting to Jesus. And notice when he gets there, Jesus asked him, what will thou have me to do for you, basically? What will you have me to do for you? What will you have me to do for you? Do you think he knew him by name? Absolutely. He knew blind Bartimaeus before he was even conceived in his mother's womb. He knew what he needed when he came to him, but he wanted him to ask. He said, you have not because you ask not. What will thou have me to do? He said, Lord, I want to see. I want to see. See you more clearly. I want to walk with you. Oh, if only I had my sight. He said, that's no problem. See, Jesus don't care what weighed you down before. Don't care, amen, about your past. He said, I'll cast your past as far as east is from west. But you know, some of us are struggling with our past. We think that's going to hold us back from following Jesus. And Jesus said, you just need to lay that cloak aside. You know, and follow me. Put that past behind you. I ain't going to remember it no more. If you just call out to me. Call out to me and ask me, hey, give you the sight. I'm going to give it to you. Change coming. Change coming. The Bible said, thou faith has made thee whole. Immediately, he could see. He received his sight on that very instant. He received his sight. But he didn't get overwhelmed with the sight and be blinded about following Jesus. He didn't get excited about the things that was around him so much that he forgot who gave him that sight. And a lot of times we get so excited about the things that are around us that we forget where those things come from. Hello? We get so excited. And those things should never take us away from the love of God. Those things shouldn't take us away from following Jesus. They should enhance us with following Jesus, but not to take us away from it. Are you with me? He didn't get so excited with the things that are around him that he didn't look to Jesus and said, I'm going to follow you. And the Bible said he followed Jesus. He followed him. What does that mean? He went out to serve him. The one who made a difference in his life and changed him from the old blind Bartimaeus who sat by the wayside begging to a child of the King. Woo! You can't get no better than that, amen? Boy, Jared, you, the other day when I baptized your son, amen, you can't get no better than that. I mean, when you accept Jesus Christ, you can't get no better than that. You're a king's kid, huh? Boy, I tell you what, that resonated with me long ago. I mean, when they used to sing old song, I don't have to settle for less because I'm a king's kid. All the riches of the kingdom now mine. I've been purchased by the blood, and I've been adopted. And now I'm living like a king's kid all the time. Woo! You know, you don't have to settle for less when you're God's child. Amen? When you're God's child, amen, you don't have to settle for less. You just need to continue to follow him and do what he commanded you to do. He'll make sure you have everything you need. And bless God, he'll give you a lot of things. Amen. But don't let those things blind you from following him. Just follow him and continue to use those things to serve him. To serve him. And you'll be blessed beyond measure. Blind Bartimaeus got a new life. Amen. A new life that day forward. He didn't allow the multitude to keep him from getting that new change. He put his cloak aside, everything that so easily beset him from running that race. He got up. Amen. He looked Jesus in the eyeball and said, Lord, I want to receive my sight. You say, how did a blind man look him in the eyeball? Just ask a blind man. He saw it all. Hello? He saw eternal life standing before him. Amen. I want that. I want my sight. I want that eternal life. Jesus said, your faith has granted it to you. And what you're going to do from this point on is up to you. And he said, I'm going to follow you, Lord. I'm going to follow you. I'm going to do what you commanded me to do. I'm going to be an effective witness. I'm going to tell others about it. Huh? My life is going to represent Christ. My life is going to reflect you, Lord. I got my sight. Yes, I've been blessed beyond measures. I can see the beautiful thing. I can see Mark's bald head today. And, you know, I can see it. And God, you know, I can see the beautiful flowers. They're just going to enhance my walk, but they're not going to hinder my walk. They're going to enhance who you are, God, in me and through me. How about you? How about you today? It's a lesson from the blind man. Because he saw it all. Hello? He knew what it was to beg and be in want. And you said, well, I ain't never begged, but you're begging for the things of this world to satisfy something that it'll never satisfy. Hello? Amen. Only one can satisfy the need that's deep in your soul today is Jesus Christ. Hello? You got to let him in. You got to cry out to him. You got to want that change. And you got to lay aside those things. And you got to follow Jesus. It's up to you. Would you stand to your feet? Father God, as I come to you right now, Lord, I thank you, God, for your words that have been sung and heard right now. And Father, with every head bowed and every eye closed and no one looking around, Father, I want to ask your people this question. Friend, today, if you're in this building today and you need a change in your life, whatever that change is, whatever that need is, would you meet me around this altar right today? Would you just step out and come all over the building? Just step out and come.